Morning, hi. Lord, I love to sing your praises. You know, there was a time when I didn't understand why certain churches, why we have what's considered a revival. But this last week felt like a revival to me. See, when you saturate your spirit with the things of God, it uplifts you in such a way that you start to feel, you know, I feel revived within myself. And this week, last week Sunday was the celebration of Palm Sunday. We reflected on Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. And Thursday was somber reflection as we took communion. And on Friday, we remembered Calvary, remembered the cross. But today, we celebrate the risen Christ. This is what it was all about. The conquering of the grave. Our redemption in flesh. I invite you to stand. Let's open up this service in a word of prayer. Lord, you came down. Father, you sent your Son. You loved the world long before the world loved you. And you gave us a way to have those guilty sins cleansed. A way, Lord, to come back to you. And it wasn't easy. It was true blood. It's true innocent blood sacrifice on Calvary's cross that we have redemption. And we thank you for that today, Lord. Today, Lord, we remember, Lord, that you didn't stay in the grave. You rose on the third day triumphantly, finishing a work that was predestined long before time, as we knew. So as we come before you today, Heavenly Father, we ask you to open up our hearts, allow your Spirit, Lord, to minister to us. Let your will, Lord, be done in our lives, in the songs that we sing, in the readings that we read. And let this service be not just a service, Lord, that we come together, Lord, but one that commemorates, that brings you honor, glory, and praise. We put this before you in Jesus' name. Amen. This morning's call to worship is themed Alleluia, and it's written by Roddy Hamilton. I will read the leader, and you will read all. We thought you were dead. We thought the cross was the end. We thought that when the stone rolled over the tomb, that was it. But this is it. We thought you had said your final word. We thought with the power had won. Those with the power had won. We thought that when you cried out, that was it. But this is it. We thought the story was finished. We thought the hope had ended. We thought that when the tomb was sealed, that was it. But this is it. This is the news. This is the moment. This is the gospel. We thought that when they crucified you, death had defeated life, and that was it. But this is it.
Love is stronger than death, and one word says it all. Hallelujah, Jesus is risen.
Hallelujah, Jesus is risen.
Good morning.
time we're going to have reading, and I'm going to invite our dear Sister Marsha Mott to come forward.
Good morning. This reading is taken from Luke chapter 24, 1 through 12. On the first day of the week, very early in the morning, the women took the spices they had prepared and went to the tomb. They found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they entered, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. While they were wondering about this, suddenly two men in clothes that gleamed like lightning stood beside them. In their fright, the women bowed down with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, "Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He has risen. Remember how he told you, while he was still with you in Galilee, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified on the third day, be raised again." Then they remembered his words. When they came back from the tomb, they told all these things to the 11 and to all the others. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the others with them who told this to the apostles. But they did not believe the women, because their words seemed to them like nonsense. Peter, however, got up and ran to the tomb, bending over. He saw the strips of linen lying by themselves, and he went away, wondering to himself what had happened.
We know what happened. He is risen. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah.
Arose with a mighty triumph on his foe.
Second reading will be done by our sister Akira Stubbs.
Good morning. Our scripture today is taken from John chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. Jesus appears to his disciples. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said to them, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone of his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Jesus appears to Thomas. Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not there when Jesus came. So the disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hand and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Then Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, yes, the Son of God, yes, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. Here ends the reading.
Amen. Amen. And by believing, you may have life in his name. Brother Eddie is going to take us out in this exciting song. He's alive again.
Like a lamb led to the slaughter, they led him off to die. Sound of swords and soldiers, shouts of crucify. Without a word of malice to the ones who left in pride, on a hill between two thieves, he hung his head and died. Now the earth did shake and tremble. The sky turned black as night. The dead came forth to testify of God and all his might. But though they crucified him, they sealed him in a tomb. No grave could ever hold him. No stone or burial room. Morning. Life filled an empty shell. The body that was cold and still was now alive and well.
Yes, sir.
And unto his disciples, the angels came and said, "Hey, go and spread the news, Ricardo. He's no longer dead. You see, he's alive again. The stone's been rolled away. He's alive again. He's no longer where he lay. He's alive again. Can't you hear the angels say, let the whole world rejoice, he's alive."
Question for you. This is for the ladies. You know, the message was given to you first. I wonder how the ladies carried that message back to Peter and the crowd. I wonder how that message was carried back. You think that was taken back like, "I got something to tell you." Ladies, why don't tell me how that happened? Imagine. Tell the man the good news you have about Easter, ladies. Let me hear you tell the man, what did the angel say? All right, that's it. God had a reason why he told the ladies. How did he tell the guys? They were gonna doubt that. They want more evidence. but the next reader.
I'll ask our sister Charlene Wallace Ferguson to come up.
This was the week that shook the world and turned it upside down. The highest high and the lowest lows of human history were recorded in this week. It started with shouts of Hosanna, Hosanna, save now. But soon after, the triumphant shout of Hosanna turned into the death cries, crucify him, crucify him. So grave was that hour that even the sun refused to shine. But this story was not to end in tragedy, for it is the greatest story ever told, the greatest truth ever recorded, the greatest triumph ever witnessed. Jesus, having tasted death, rose victoriously over death and took as his captives all who believe on his name and place their trust in him. Death has been neutralized by the master who has all power in heaven and earth in his hands. Jesus is alive to rule forever as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His name be forever blessed.
Thank you. Our God reigns.
Proclaiming news.
Our God reigns. Our God reigns. How many of you believe that today? Because that's the reason you should be here today. Because our God reigns. Right now, we're going to be treated to a special performance by our Ministry Seekers dancers. And as they're setting up, trying to clear the stage, I want to reflect back years ago when my daughter used to watch the dances, and she wanted to be a dancer. Well, you know, not everybody has these special gifts. So you could imagine what it's like to try to break the news to your child that you can't be a part of this right now. But there is hope. So, honey, in the future, you may be a part of this team that is dancing up here today. So without further ado, if they're ready, let's have the Ministry Seekers dancers.
Screaming
We could do better than that. We could do much better than that. Woo! I think it was David that said we should praise the Lord in the dance. In the dance. And that's how you do it. Right there. Don't worry, my daughter will be in the group probably in the next session. At this point in time in the service, I'm going to ask our dear brother Adam to come up and we'll go through our scripture verse to remember. Brother Adam.
Good morning, Grace. All right, right after the joyful time, it's exam time. All right. Last year we did the Beatitudes, and remember there was blessed is the peacemakers, for they are? Oh, y'all are terrible today. They are the peacemakers, for they will be called the sons of God. All right. And later in that same chapter is when we come up to this. But I tell you, read with me, Matthew 5, 44 and 45. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. Now, it's kind of amazing that this last landed right in Easter week. Who was the ultimate peacemaker? I know we could get this. Okay, with a little bit more confidence. All right. All right, so we got this together now. The same guy who's preaching right now is the ultimate peacemaker, and he actually was the Son of God. We getting how this works now? Amen. All right, so next week is the first of the test weeks. So we get to read. This is the last time. Ooh. All right. Matthew 5, read with me. Matthew 5, 44 through 45. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. See y'all next week.
Thank you, Adam. At this time, we're gonna welcome our guests. And if you're visiting with us today and you sign the guest log, as I read your name, I want you to stand, remain standing. Michelle Earl. From St. Louis, the cousin of Jean Culmer. Welcome. I have Mr. Garth Brooks. No? No? Is that you? That was a joke. Ah. So, okay, so who is it? Is you? Stan. And what is your name, sir? Okay, that's fine. We have Jean Charles. I have here Luckinson Claricia. I hope I got that right. I probably messed that right up. Cara Russell. Where are you, Cara? Oh, right in the back. I see you. Welcome. We also have Nikes McDonald. Welcome. Is there anybody else visiting who didn't get an opportunity to sign the visitor's log with us? You just show your hand and stand. Welcome. Welcome. Well, we are honored that you have chosen to worship with us today and trust that you will be encouraged and spiritually refreshed in the Lord. All of our guests are invited to complete a visitor's questionnaire, including your postal and email address. And usually we would have a reception in your honor, but as today is the big Sunday, we didn't have a reception planned today, but come back next week and we will have a reception planned for you in your honor. You can have some light refreshments and meet our leadership team. We're gonna now look at the birthdays and anniversaries that are being celebrated in this beautiful month. I will start with the birthdays. And on the 26th of April, we have our sister, Stanice Mortimer. We have Christian Brown. And we have LaShanta Knowles. On the 25th of April, we have Dr. Winston Phillips, Cameron Sweeting, and Mason Knowles. On the 24th of April, we have our dear brother, Adrian Curry, Denise Wilson Jr., Stephen Bain, Annika Darvill, Anna Mashavish, and Jordan Phillips. Oh, that's Danny Wilson Jr. Didn't I say that? No, I didn't. On the 23rd, we have Nerlaine DeMercy. On the 22nd, we have Sister Christy Colley and Serenity Williams. And on the 20th, which is today, celebrating our dear Sister Marcia Seymour and Dillian Curry. Yeah, let's give them a round of applause. Anniversaries for this month. On the 26th, we have Randy and Suzanne Rowe. Also on the 26th, we have Tyrone and Donnelly Sayers. And on the 25th, it's a heavy one. We've got our Elder Stewart and Sister Allison Kelly. Allison is just beaming, glowing. Look at her. You love your husband. Hey, I know. Pastor Annika, we have a song for these beautiful people today. This time I'm going to bring our song leader back up to lead us in the Easter greeting, Elder Cyril Pete.
Soon and very soon, let's all stand as we get ready to greet somebody.
Oh,
back in place now. Everyone should have gotten touched by somebody next to them. All right? Thank you. You may be seated.
I love it when we get an opportunity to just greet each other in the congregation, go out and give a firm shake and a brotherly hug and a sisterly hug, just a fellowship. I like that. I like that. You need to do some more of that, Pastor Hannah. I like that. At this time, I'm going to go through the news items, and most of it is in your bulletin, so I won't belabor it, but I will highlight one or two points. What's not in the bulletin is that those persons that were interested in the CDs for the Ted Cunningham event, our elder Cardinal McCarty has them available now, and he will have a table set up outside for you to purchase if you so desire. So that's the first item that's not on your in your bulletin. As you know, the Marriage and Honorable Service is coming up, so you're going to look for persons who have been married 50 years or more to enter. If you know couples that have been married for 50 years or more and you want to enter them in, please submit their names to the church office. The Care for Family Fellowship Luncheon, I know last week we had decided that it would have been, I think it was the last Sunday in May, but we've moved it now to the first Sunday in June. So the first Sunday in June will be when we would have the Care for Family Luncheon Fellowship. And for those that may not be familiar with this is where you invite a family or two to your house who you've never had before and treat them to some lunch. And my family is always available for that. Thank you. Okay, I want us to remember the special prayers. Those persons on our special prayer list, those bereaved families. Another reminder is that the Awana Clubs and Word of Life is closed for the Easter break until May 3rd. On May 3rd, they will reopen. Grace Initiative reading class as well. With that being said, I'm going to ask the ushers to come forward. And I'm going to ask you to stand as we prepare to lift the offering and recite the offertory covenant. Proverbs 3, 9 and 10, Luke 6 and 38. Honor the Lord with your wealth, with the first fruits of all your substance. Then your barns will be filled to overflowing, and your vats will brim over with new wine. Give, and it will be given to you. A good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, will be poured into your lap. For with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Heavenly Father, we come before you again, Lord, bringing offerings, bringing tithes, bringing gifts of love. And we ask you, Lord, to take this financial gift, bless it for the furthering of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Whilst the offering is being lifted, we're going to have special music from the best choir in the country, also known as Jess Grace. And they're going to treat us and song titled The Revelation Song. You may have.
of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder. Blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Sing holy,
holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to Kings, you are my everything, and I will adore you. And I will adore you,
filled with wonder. Struck wonder at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery.
Yes, Grace. Let's give them another round of applause. In the midst of technical difficulties, they came through just as we expected. Ripe and ready. Just Grace. Amen. Well, without further ado, I'm going to bring the man of the hour to bring God's word to us. The spiritual food that we will receive for today amidst our worship and praise, I ask Pastor Lyle to come forward at this time.
complicated.
Good afternoon. Have you enjoyed being in the presence of the Lord, reflecting on the great passion of Christ for us? We serve a marvelous God. We serve a marvelous God. Just before I get going, there are some persons I think it's only fitting that as a church we take a minute to recognize. And if I can figure out what just happened with my notes. Oh, there they are. Elder Andy Knowles has left to go on the Carifter swim team as one of the coaches. But in his place, his son Elliot has returned with his blushing, beautiful bride, Erin. And so Elliot and Erin, please stand up and be recognized. This is, for some of the newer members, this is Elder Andy Knowles' last son and daughter-in-law. And they're visiting with us for the Easter season. Good to have you guys. Have a seat. Then I see Sister Regina, Gina Smith popped in to pay us a visit. Shocked her mom half to death. Gina, just stand up and wave. I think I saw Brent Outen sitting over there. We haven't seen Brother Brent in a little while. Did I see Brent Outen over there somewhere? No, there we are. Brent, just stand up and be acknowledged. I haven't seen him in a while. Tyro and Stacy have brought a new life to church. We haven't seen the life before because it was hidden away in Stacy's tummy. But I got a quick glimpse of the baby. Where's Tyro and Stacy? Right in front of me. Just stand up and wave and let the folks see that baby. There we go. All right. Janet is a Grammy again. All right. Okay. And folks, this last I also see a number of our members, friends, and so forth who have come in for the Easter. We welcome all of you. But this last person I want to especially draw our attention to because, you know, she left for a simple operation. And twice, death attempted to seize her and take her out of this life. And we'll be talking about death and his defeat in a minute. But the prayers of the saints prevailed. And as a result, a young lady by the name of Dawn Taylor is sitting in our congregation today. Dawn Taylor, you need to stand up and give God some glory. Because you caused me to miss plenty sleep, fretting over you and taking your cause to the Lord. And this congregation is overjoyed because God heard our cry, heard our pleas for your help. And a gracious and marvelous God has redeemed and restored you back to himself. Church, be praying for me. I have spent 2 days and night in excruciating pain, blinding pain. I have an abscess. Some of you might be able to see from that distance, my face is somewhat swollen. Got a ping from a friend this morning, and she asked me how I was doing. You know I don't lie, so I told her, well, actually not well. I told her my face is aching and my tooth is aching. And she said, oh, it sounds like I have an abscess. I said, yes, and I've been treating with medication and antibiotics and drugs. And she says, I said, boy, I don't think I'm going to be able to preach today. Well, did I get a lesson from her? This is an old school friend from high school. Said, that don't sound like the Lyle Bethel I know from high school. So I remember when you had a muscle cramp and you shouldn't have ran, but you ran anyway because you don't give up. I say, Lord, look what the Lord putting on me today. I was going to ask Carlisle Peart. I almost called him in the middle of the night to say, my brother, you up? Because Pastor Rex is not available. And I know he would have done an able job. But after I got that Holy Spirit whipping from a former member, classmate, this is Jackie Ritchie, Jasmine. Yeah. I said, okay, I have no choice. I must speak to the people of God, and I exactly asked that the Lord would deliver. I had hoped to spend those 2 days in meditation and seeking the Lord on that, but as it turned out, I've had to cobble some other things together, and I believe you're going to be blessed. My message today is called The Day Death Was Defeated. The Day Death Was Defeated. 1 Corinthians 15, 55 through 57. O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is your victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Oh, Lord, I pray that you would cause your servant to do justice to what you want to say to us this most glorious day, the greatest day on the Christian calendar, the day we remember the passion of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, realized, brought to fruition in the saving of souls on the day that you were raised from the dead, signaling that the sacrifice has been accepted. And we, Adam's lost children, can be saved. Thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. Thank you that you established the church. And broken and ruined sinners can come in and be helped and enriched and ennobled and their lives restored and renewed. And they can witness and be a testimony for you. And we can look forward to a life. And though death may interrupt for a season, death has been defeated, and we will have eternal life with you. Bless now this message time. Use it that your Son, Jesus, would be glorified. Come, Holy Spirit, continue to help us as we worship, that our hearts on this Easter day would be so overwhelmed with love that we would henceforth continue to give you the best of ourselves in worship and service. To this end, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I've been to many, many, many funerals. I can still remember the first one. I've seen death as a little boy and tried so hard to understand. Why won't this, whether it was a puppy or a family member, why won't they wake up? Why? What a horrible thing to see is their skin gets that sallow color and they're... You can't shake them. I mean, shaking does nothing. They're gone. They've gone. And all of us know that death is a certainty. Death comes for everyone. Rich, poor, black and white, slave, free, doesn't matter who you are. Death takes you. And the tragedy is death doesn't just come for the old. Babies die in the womb. Little children die. And death has a number of things in his arsenal. Sickness, illness, these things precipitate death coming to take us out of this life. Death. Death is an enemy to the human race. Death. Oh, would that we would be free of death. Would that we would not have to endure another funeral. The passing of a loved one. We can never, ever get used to their absence around the family dinner table. They're gone. Death has them in its grip. And were we to try to somehow hold on to them even in death and prop them up, and death will take them and their flesh will rot and they're gone. No one has been able to deal with death until this day that we celebrate. We sang, death could not keep its prey. Jesus, my Savior, he tore the bars away. Jesus, my Lord. I'm going to bring a message today that is undoubtedly one of the most unusual messages you will ever hear around Easter, because I'm going to chronicle for you death's biography. in a message called The Day That Death Was Defeated. You're going to need to use your imagination as you come along with me. Let's begin with the birth and the early years of death. I believe that we can pinpoint the exact date of the birth of death. You ever thought of that? Death was born one day. Death was born. Pastor Lyle, what are you talking about? Yeah, death was born. There was a time when death was not. But then death was born. Death was conceived in Adam and Eve's temptation and birthed the moment they sinned. Scripture records the birth. As by one man, Adam, sin entered into the world, and death by sin. There was no death before. No death before. The parent of death is sin, and the grandparent of death is Satan. Again, Scripture tells us that whosoever committed sin is of the devil. And so on the day that Adam fell to temptation and sin, there was a bouncing baby boy born into the household of the devil by the name of death. I said there was a time. There was a time before death's birth that this old world was a pleasant place to live. No thorns, no thistles, no pain, no travail, no labor. The fruit of the land yielded itself willingly and abundantly. Can you imagine? In the Garden of Eden, you had to be careful how you ate that apple. Or, no, let's not say apple, because you think I mean that apple. You know, we think it's an apple. It wasn't really. Be careful how you ate that orange, because you miss and drop the seed. Come back in a couple of days, you got a sapling. This soil is just so ready to thrive and to produce and bring forth life. The human body was made perfectly to last throughout eternity. Do you know that? We were made to last eternally. God made us so. But death changed all of that. Death changed it for every one of us. And with death came thorns, thistles, pain, travail. The human body began to decay and to deteriorate. Now we know when man was first made, his body was clearly far superior to ours. We have Methuselah living to, what, 969? Right, 969. I mean, wow. Awesome age. But then we see round about the time of Abraham, folks are living 120, 180 years, so we're seeing that begin to drop. And now we hear the scripture say 70 years, 80 by reason of strength. The average person, of course, we have some stalwarts who, according to the newspapers, lived 102, 105, and so forth. But the human life, we are deteriorating even as we're dying. We're deteriorating. But death was very active in his early years. And it doesn't take us long to see him surface with Cain and Abel. Motivated by jealousy, he strikes down his brother in a field and leaves him there to be devoured by death. 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 And blood. Death rapidly becomes the strongest predator on planet Earth. Death. Devouring human beings. Relentless. Tracking down every single victim, animal, bird, fish, human, plant life. Death has a stranglehold on all that lives, grabbing us in our prime and wrestling us into the dust from whence we came until we rot away and worms take our body. Death reigns supreme. Death has been lurking in the shadows with the souls of men in his grasp. He is a terror of the night, and he plays no favorites, and he's certainly not prejudiced. He goes for everyone. He leaps upon the old, the young, men, women, and children alike. Red and yellow, black and white, none are precious in his sight, for he takes all. He stalks the land wherever he goes, taking lives with him. He's ever present, ever using the schemes and machinations of men and women to bring death on others. We see it in Ahab and Jezebel, who devise an evil scheme to kill Naboth and to take his property. We see death go into the fire with the three Hebrew boys, expecting to have their charred bodies, only to be robbed of victory by the fourth man in the fire. Went in that fiery furnace. Say, three more, I got these fellas. And while he is there about to pounce on them and hold them and burn and be there in the burning of them to death, no smoke can touch them. No fire can scorch their flesh, because there's a fourth man in the fire. There's a fourth man in the fire. Y'all ain't hear me. There's a fourth man in the fire, and death cannot touch anyone when the fourth man there is with you. You see, this fourth man in the fire was the Son of God. Even Nebuchadnezzar had to say it. Wait a minute. Wait. Didn't we tie up tree fellas and put it up? Who is that fourth man? And his appearance is like the appearance of the gods. He knew, death did, that he would eventually get these three boys. And he hoped he would have another encounter with that fourth man in the fire. And so death was patient. Brothers and sisters, I put it to you that at the mere mention of death's name, men tremble. He is our ancient enemy, and he is feared. He lurks and he brings terror into our hearts. When sickness comes, we know that death is not far. Death. Death over the years could boast that of the millions of men, and I would say billions of men and women, who he has taken out of this life, only two had escaped his clutches. Enoch and Elijah, these two men never died. For it says of Enoch, Enoch was, and he walked with God and was not, for God took him. Didn't die. Death was waiting around, figured I could grab him soon, and couldn't because he was gone. And then the other fellow was Elijah. Death figured that the same Jezebel he used to take Naboth out of this life, and who he used to kill the prophets of God, he used that same Jezebel and her wicked schemes to get rid of this Elijah. And remember, she threatened him and said, listen, may it be done to me and more beside if by this time tomorrow you are not like the prophets you have killed. Remember, he ran for his life, had that 40-day experience where he got his faith rekindled, his faith renewed. He got a reassignment, and God worked in his life, gave him someone to replace him. And Elijah was able to continue on in ministry. But before death could even look his way, the Bible says the horsemen of Israel came down and snatched him and took him away. Death knows two men escaped his pernicious grasp, and he was not able to grab them. Then death began his most ambitious undertaking. In his wanderings around the earth, death received word that the fourth man in the fire, the very Son of God, had taken upon himself human flesh. Well, death knows God's law. Human flesh dies in this dispensation. Human flesh, anyone born of a woman, born in human flesh, dies. He knows that. Unless God would somehow remove them, he knows those who are born of woman will die. And so death would wait for an opportunity to take him. He stirred up Herod, And Herod set about a bloody purge and killed all those little babies, 2 years and under, in Bethlehem. But he didn't find the fourth man in the fire, because God had spirited him away and took him to Egypt. There were many times in the earthly ministry of Jesus, you hear this, and then the people sought to kill him, but it was not his time. And so he walked through their midst. He walked through their midst. Brothers and sisters, Jesus would say, listen, no man can take my life. I take it up, and I am the one who lays it down. He had full authority over his life. Though death was thwarted in his previous attempts, death feels certain that the time is right. The Son of Man was coming to Jerusalem as Messiah. And death believes that he will use this time to get him. Now, friends, we started off Palm Sunday with the crowds. With the crowds cheering, Hosanna to the Son of David. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. And look at this Jesus. Friends, common sense would say that he's coming now to save us, to truly save us from the hated Romans and set up his earthly kingdom. Isn't that what Messiah is supposed to do? But brothers and sisters, by the end of the week and starting this day, we would recognize that no, he came to do the greater work of saving us, not from outside forces, the hated Roman or whatever jurisdiction or government is in operation, but he came to save us from sin and the condemnation of sin, and the fact that the devil had a hold on us, and we would accompany him to where he is going outside of the presence of God. Jesus came to deliver us from that verdict and that sentence. And that, brothers and sisters, was the greater work. That is why when they wanted to make him king, he said no. That is why, despite all that was going on to promote him to that high office, he said, no, my kingdom is a spiritual kingdom, because he came with you and I in mind. And so death now, thinking that this is an opportunity for him to ruin the Son of Man, Jesus will use death to accomplish his purposes for sinful humanity. Death is moving about in that last week with the guards, going with them to the Garden of Gethsemane. He is stirring all and sundry up against him. There are beatings, there are floggings, there's punches to the face, there is spitting. There is stirring up Pontius Pilate, who we saw on Good Friday with an excellent reading. Who was that? Naldo that helped us with the Pontius Pilate? Was that Naldo's contributions? We saw how on at least three or four occasions, Pilate, knowing this man is innocent, was trying to get him off. Send him to Herod. That didn't work. He figured, well, you know, these people just want blood. Let me beat him, and then they will say, you know, okay, he suffered enough. That didn't work. Then he says, you know what? Let me offer them Barabbas, an insurrectionist, a terrible man that all would agree, Romans and Jews. And they chose him. That didn't work. Three strikes. This man realized, man, you all ain't gonna set me up like this. So he washes his hands publicly. Listen, I have nothing to do with this. Three to four times, he tries to absolve himself of this horrendous guilt. But friends, the scriptures say, all of this was a part of the preordained plan of God to rescue sinners like you and I. You see, the entire Old Testament sacrificial system was but a shadow of the real thing that was coming. That is, Jesus would be the perfect lamb and the perfect high priest offering the lamb, and the perfect high priest going behind the veil into the Holy of Holies so that we might be saved. And not there for a day, but for eternity, he intercedes for the saints. And so all of this is not an accident. It is a part of the preordained plan of God. And men and women's wills will be used to accomplish, not just men and women, Satan's will be used. This is how sovereign God is. God uses the devil's venom against the Son of God to accomplish his plan. Friends, if there's nothing that awes me about God, it's that. You see, because from the day he told Adam and Eve and the devil inhabiting the body of the serpent, he says, listen, the seed of this woman will crush your head. From that day until now, the devil had been looking to crush anybody who would be the one who would destroy his kingdom. And so his venomous rage caused him to believe, if I can eliminate them, they won't destroy my work. But he couldn't read deeply into the scriptures and understand that it is in the act of trying to eliminate the Savior that you will bring about your own demise. What a marvelous God we serve, who outwits the witty, who outcrafts the crafty. And he uses the devil's venomous plan to bring about his will. So death tries to use Pontius Pilate. And when he saw Pilate not working along, he stirred up the crowd, crucify him, crucify him. And so here it is. All the players present, Pilate, the Roman governor, the Jewish high priest, who had prophesied that year, it is expedient that one die for the nation. But they didn't understand it. They thought it was expedient that this one rebellious fellow die so that the Jewish nation does not get destroyed by the Romans. No, but it was expedient that this one die that the nation might be saved. He didn't get it. He knew, he got the word from God, but did not interpret it correctly. So with death shouts, Pilate finally pronounces that Jesus is to be killed. And he delivers him over to be crucified. Many artists have tried to help us with these moments in song. You could imagine all the principalities and powers. Because friends, you and I may have not have known who Jesus was, but they knew. Every time Jesus showed up, every demon present knew who he was. We know who you are, they would say. Have you come to torment us before the time? Check that out. They know that they don't run things. They know that they got but a season to do what they want to try to do. But they themselves know that the Son of God will come and deal with them. They know it. And so when they saw him, first response is always, we know who you are. Have you come to torment us before the time? So you can imagine all the principalities and powers all around the world. You think the Jews came to Jerusalem for the Passover? I want you to know that every principality and power was in Jerusalem to watch this. We have got the Son of God, and we're going to destroy him. We're going to crucify him. And if he thought he could be one who would save people, we could turn him into sin, because God says in his word, the one who hangs on a tree is accursed. So he cannot be the one who will save God's people. We can make him accursed. We can crucify him. Played right into God's plan. You see, because here's what the scripture said. God made him who had no sin to be sin for himself? No. To be sin for us, so that through him we might become the righteousness of God. You see, folks, if the devil in all of his malice and guile knew how to read the Bible, he would have realized the last thing in the world we would do is let this fellow get crucified. That's the last thing we want to do. They would have been telling Pilate, leave this man alone. Would have been working with Pilate's wife. They would have said, listen, do anything, but don't hang him on no tree. Let him go off into obscurity. Don't let him be a sin sacrifice. But friends, I'm here to tell you today, this God that we serve is a sovereign God. He outthinks the devil 10 times over. And all that the devil wants to do to your life, listen, that God will use all his devilish plots, even what the devil meant for ruin to you. He will turn that into a ministry. Every 2 years or so, I go to the American Association of Christian Counseling. And I'm always amazed at the different kinds of ministries they have there. One time, I'm strolling through the big auditorium with all of the booths and book sales and so forth. And I'm going along. I see this one. There's a child, a little girl, like she's crying. It looks like she's been abused. I thought, wow. Wow, it's such a haunting picture. So I'm looking at the picture, and a lady walks up. And she says, can I help? I says, yeah, I take it that your ministry is obviously dedicated to helping people who have been abused. And she says, yes. We talk for a while, and she says, can I tell you something, Pastor? Because by then I've told her who I was, where I'm from. She says, you know, I was abused as a child for a long time. She told me who the perpetrator was and so forth, and how that just about ruined her life. 3-4 abortions, just drug, everything. It just destroyed her. But then Jesus found her. Then Jesus found her and transformed her and took all of her pain, all of her wretchedness, all of her shame, all of that abuse, and transformed it into a ministry. And, you know, I'm just a little old pastor. All I do is preach to people. I'm just a mouth for God, but there are these relics. There are these treasures who are out there. There are these nuggets of gold that I run into all the time. And I say, Lord, boy, you see, now, is this the kind of thing that lets me know that I ain't gonna get half the rewards other people can get in heaven? You see, folks, don't believe because I sit up here and I can preach and do all that I somehow in life at Key in heaven and you in Bain Town. No! No, friends. No, it don't go like that. You be faithful with what you have, and you let God take your little life, and you let him transform that, and it's over. Friends, man, choose which side you're on, man. Choose which side you're on. The God that we serve could take anything that has happened to you, anything, and transform that into a powerful ministry to the saving of lives. Don't sit there and say, the Lord can't use me. I say all the time, Lord, can't use me. I was a ruined woman. Oh, I, if you only knew, Pastor, about my life, you wouldn't take much of me. I say, ma'am, you ain't got to worry about what I think about you, and I think very highly of you because of your conviction. But let me tell you something. God thinks so much of you that he sent his only begotten son to die for you. And the Bible says this. We are his workmanship. We are his masterpiece, created in Christ Jesus to do good works that God prepared in advance for him to do. The devil has been ruining lives, and God pursues those ruined lives and bring them back. Exhibit A, William Booth, Salvation Army. Saving many a drunkard, many a ruined life on the side of the road that me and you look at, walk over and say, my God. God looks at and say, my son, I gotta send one of my loved ones to come and get you, to come and rescue you. By God's grace, I have been fortunate to be a part of ministries like that in the inner cities of places like Chicago and other places who recognize that no life is wasted. No life should be looked down on. And these ministries dedicate resources, funds, and people to save lives. Why? Because they realize that Christ died for them. For them. No one is past redemption. No one. While there is life and breath, there is an opportunity to repent and come to the Lord Jesus Christ. There's hope. Let's never give up on anybody. I can tell you there's a lot of people who have some bad experiences with church, Ooh, they don't like church. They like Jesus, but they don't like his people. I always tell them, don't mind that man. Every tree got a couple of nuts in it. God family, even in your own family, you probably got a few whatever. But listen, you stay in with God's church. You stay with God's church. It's the best place for you. Best place for you. Better than any political party? Let me tell you something. Those political parties, you think, well, the F&M against the PLP will get in any of those, and you will see F&M's against F&M's. If you try to rise, they can jerk you. And PLP is against PLP. If you try to rise, they can stand on your head. So even the appearance of being together ain't the same. Listen, this ain't no support system. I for you as far as we could get there together. But beyond that, boy, you's a threat to me, and I can make sure you don't rise. Not so with the church. Not so with the church. We're here to build one another up. 52 commands. Love one another. Pray for one another. Exhort one another. Bear one another's burdens. Carry one another's burdens. It's all there. Man, yeah, you can have a few quacks in the church, but I'd rather be in the church than any place else. They got you back. And let me just say here, because, boy, in my travels as a pastor, I run into all sorts of people. Boy, pastor, I like you. I like you, but some of these churches I don't like. Some of these pastors I don't like. I say, you know what? Give the church another chance. Give the church. And if that church offended you, look at another church. Just make sure the word of God is taught there. Just make sure. Well, pastor, I come into your church. I said, now, let me clear now. I am not saying my church is perfect. I'll tell you one thing. They ought to be, because I preach righteousness. Boy, we shouted witness in here today. There's not one person in this church could say they got an excuse to be in no club carrying on like there's a sinner. Not one of you. Because you don't hear it from this pulpit. No, sir. No, sir. I call you endlessly to recognize that you've been called with a high calling. Called to live worthy of the calling you've received. Called to be Christ one. Called to be Christ-like in all that you do and all that you say. But Pastor, this is how I've always been. And is there a point that you're trying to make? No, sir. We're called to be like Christ. So if you got a stink attitude, put it under the cross. And let the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, goodness, kindness, gentleness, self-control, now be what your life is known for and by. Yeah. But I digress. Let's get back now. Death still trying to hold our Jesus. And you know, he tried to hold him with that scourging. Y'all recognize Jesus should have been dead from the scourging alone, right? Oh, let me tell you about the scourging. You see, the whips that the Romans used had glass, nail, all those things in it. And so when they hit you, bah, broke skin. And when they pull back like that, they rip in flesh. 39 times. And oh, by the way, before that, they have beaten him senseless with rods. Now, folks, let me tell you something. I was going to disobey God if I was an angel. Oh, someone was going to get hurt. When you see that first Roman soldier raise his hand like that, bring it. Dead. Dead. So, Lord, you're going to have to do something about that one, man. Huh? Next one raises his hand. Juk! You think I'm an angel, I can let you stand there and kill the delight of heaven? God's only son in human flesh? Boy, I know how them angels stood back. I don't know how they stood back, but we know that they were standing back. Remember what Jesus said? Man, Peter, put that sword away, man. Don't you know, Peter? Don't you know, Peter? That with one word I can release 12 legions of angels. Legion, over 2,000. He could decimate the land of Palestine, Jerusalem, Canaan, whatever you want to call it. We are talking power under restraint. Power under restraint. So death was hoping he could take him and every one of them whipping. Jesus wouldn't die. He punks on Jesus, say, well, you're going now. But he'd be repelled. He'd be repelled. He can't take Jesus. Y'all realize the Jesus, what he said, right? No man. More than no man. Nothing on earth can take my life. So death could not take his life. Y'all need to hear me in here today. Death could not take Jesus. Listen to what he says. I lay down my life. And what does he say? What does he say on the cross? Father, into your hands I commit my spirit. And he gave up the ghost. You see, friends, death could only receive him. What Jasmine saying? Jasmine, what was those precious words? They could not. Could not. Though they tried, they could not. You see, friends, Jesus is the author of life. He's the author of life. I want you, starting from this Easter forward, to understand, man, some of us have been doing Jesus wrong. We've been doing Jesus dead wrong, man. He loves you to pieces, loves you to death, gives you eternal life. And some of us only got time for him on a Sunday. And a piece of Sunday, not the whole Sunday even. A piece of Sunday. Friends, Jesus deserves your whole life all the time. All the time. You need to give him. What does the song say? He wants it all. You need to give him your all. Okay, so there he is on the cross. There he is on the cross. All of the principalities and powers from all over the earth, they're all there. And if you think man is saying, since you be the Son of God, prove it to us. Come down off that cross, man. If you think men are jeering at him, what you think about the principalities and powers? Can you imagine the orgy, the feast of rage they had on him on the cross? And is Jesus on that cross because he's pinned there by the nails? No. No, he's pinned there by the will of God. The love of God and his love for broken, sinful humanity. And finally, death watches him slump his head after he says some truly powerful words. You see, he said at least some seven, there's some seven utterances that we know that he said. But one of the couple of things he said that just want to draw your attention to, he says, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that would be the nature of his saving work. That his work is that the Father would forgive us, for we do not know what we are doing. And finally he said, it is finished. But a better translation, the debt is paid. The debt is paid. The debt is paid. You see, as much as it sounds dramatic and I like to say it is finished, our tendency is to think he's saying, I am finished. Our tendency is to kind of transliterate what he's saying to, I am finished, I'm tired now, I'm going to die. And that's why I believe the better translation is the debt is paid. So now I can give up the ghost. The debt is paid. I have become for them the kinsman redeemer. I, who knew no sin, have become sin for them, so that through me they might become the righteousness of God. The debt is paid. It is finished. I'm gone. And he bows his head and gives up the ghost. And now death can claim him. Now death can claim him. And death still doesn't know what's really going on. But I'll tell you one thing, something strange is going on, because the sun refuses to shine for 3 hours. The earth itself recoils from this, and there's a mighty earthquake. And it is said, we know the Bible don't lie, many tombs were open. Persons came to life. So while the deaf try to hold on to this one, so While he's using all of his energies to hold on to this one, others are coming out of their tomb. Well, I wish I had a church here, because someone ought to be telling the Lord hallelujah. The devil now says, something is up. Listen, death. I miss and hear him say something. What did he say? Destroy this temple in 3 days. Destroy this temple, and after 3 days I'll raise it. Listen, death. Hold him. I want you to hold him for 3 days. Hold him for 4 days, man. At least hold him. Hold him. What you need to help us hold him? I can give you a legion of demons. You need to hold him? Hold him down. This fella said on many occasions he could come back to life after 3 days. Hold him. Day one. All is well. Celebrations continuing. Principality over Peru and them showing the new jig they is due in Peru. Principality over there in Australia showing them the waltz and the cha-cha they is due over there. Big time party. Day two, no problem. Party continues. Keep serving them spirits. Get it? Day three, death is feeling a little faint, brothers and sisters. Then it happens. Up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph over his foes. He arose the victor from the dark domain, and he lives forever with his saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah. Christ arose. Brothers and sisters, death could not keep his prey. Jesus, our Savior, he tore the bars away. No matter how much demons you put on that assignment, no matter how much of them you try and sit on him. When they went to look for his body, the grave clothes couldn't hold him. You know, the grave clothes were still the way they ought to be, and he passed right through him. And just to show that he meant business, he folded up the one who was on his head. Brothers and sisters, there's no sweeter joy in a pastor's life than to declare over a funeral that this is not the end. Amen. This is not the end. I want to remind you that Jesus rose from the grave. Death can no longer hold sway over the life of a believer. It could not keep its greatest prey. And its greatest prey, Jesus, says, I am he that liveth and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore, and I hold the keys of hell, death, and the grave. I hold it. Huh? I hold it. I'm the one who's in charge around here. I hold the keys of hell and death. I determine who lives and who dies. I can say to this one, rise, and he rises. I hold the keys of hell, grave, and death. Scripture saying, having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a public spectacle of them. He shamed them. He humiliated the demonic realm, humiliated them. And all of their claims, all of their wretched claims against humanity, Jesus nailed it with the law to the cross. And the devil now, whatever claim you want to claim against the life of a believer, go take it up against the cross, because my debt is paid. My debt is paid. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is your sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? Friends, as we close, understand this. Death is but a blip and a temporary temporary stop in our opportunity to see our beloved family members again. That's all death is. Death is a servant of the Lord. And the scriptures tell us that there will come a day when death himself will be destroyed. Brothers and sisters, Jesus Christ has shown his mastery over life, death, principalities and powers, and the grave. Let him show his mastery over your life as well. As we close, I'd like to encourage you again. Won't you show your passion for this Christ who loved you so by committing yourself fully to serve him and to be a vessel that he can use? Let's be done with sin. Jesus died to overcome sin. Let's be done with being used of the devil to do wrong. Jesus saved us from that. Let us show our true worship of God by using our hands, our hearts, our lives, all that we are, to win souls for his kingdom. Let's stand for prayer. By the way, friends, it's a beautiful sight for the praise team, the worship leader, the song leader, to look down and see the saints of God here. You have no idea how beautiful this is, to see souls that are precious in the sight of the Lord, that knew that they needed to be here, that knew that they wanted to hear a word from the Lord, that they wanted to be in this place to worship him. And I never take it for granted. I'm grateful for my friend who told me, "You got to preach today, Pastor. Pain or not, you got to preach." And friends, God has been good. I haven't had any pain, but I want you to pray. I want you to pray for me. Whether this is medicated absence of pain. Thank you. And since my Bible say, where two or three are gathered in his name, there he is in the midst. And if two or three agree as touching anything, I want us to agree together that the Lord would deliver me from this pain, that I could spend this Easter meditating and putting together more messages for the church that Jesus loves so much. And while we're praying together, pray for all of our health, all of our homes, all of our families, and pray that Jesus would reign in this land, that this issue of crime would be done away with, rapings and murders and thefts would be set aside. Let's look to the God who's able, shall we? Lord Jesus, we celebrate you this day. You are a great and awesome God. You deserve all the glory. You deserve all the praise. You deserve all that we have to give you in this life. Oh, Lord, transfix our thoughts and our attentions to you. Help us, Lord, to give the best of what we are in service to you. We give you our lives. We pray, Lord, that just as you have conquered death for us,